We got no food. We got no jobs. Our pets' heads are falling off.
Hey, Eamon.
Hey, sir. How's it going?
Not too bad. How are you?
Oh, Grant. Good to see you again. It's been a while.
I know, it must be like 10 years, right?
I think so, yeah. Ever since football up in the pitches.
Yeah. So we'll get straight into it. This is Dr. Eamon Laird. He is a research fellow at Trinity University. Not correct, Eamon. That's up to date.
Yeah, Trinity and University of Limerick.
Limerick as well. Very good. Yeah. So, Eamon, I was looking a bit into your work and things, and I was trying to figure out how many papers and stuff that you have written, and I got to like 100, and then I just gave up, and I thought, I'll just ask you.
Yeah, well, I'm not even sure myself. I think it's maybe 120, 130, something like that. After a while, you just sort of, well, not forget, but like, there's too many to count.
There's so many, yeah. No, it's such a diverse range. I know vitamin D is a common theme throughout. Are you still studying in and around vitamin D, or have you other things that you're looking at?
Yeah, still a bit of a D in the side, but mostly now it's lifestyle medicine with the University of Limerick. So it's looking at physical activity, mental health, depression, nutrition, a combination of everything together rather than just one component, multiple components.
Yeah.
For longevity.
Very good. So I know you from Coleraine University. That's where I studied, and then I stayed on, got a job as a research assistant up there in the business department, and then I met you through indoor football, from kicking each other every Friday at 5 o'clock.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that was good. That was fun.
Yeah. Yeah, I know, and we need to do it again sometime. Get the old gang, the gang back together again. But yeah. What were you doing? Were you researching up in Coleraine, or what brought you up to Coleraine?
Yeah, so I started a degree in human nutrition, my undergraduate, and then in 2009 I did a PhD then in vitamin D in Coleraine. And then at 2012, then I moved down to Trinity College in Dublin. So I stayed with Trinity until about, 2022, probably this year. Yeah, and then I moved to, with University of Limerick.
Yeah, very good. Yeah. And so where are you? So at the moment, what are you focusing on with regards to career? Are you currently based in Dublin still, or are you moving around?
Yeah, fortunately, I'm still in Dublin. I'm able to work remotely from here, so it's been pretty good. So best of both in Dublin, but also with a different university as well, a different sort of mindset as well of like a whole lifestyle medicine approach.
Yeah, very good. Now, I was looking through some of your papers, and probably the more recent ones, I guess the common theme was there's some studies to do with COVID and vitamin D levels. Have things changed with regards to what we thought about vitamin D levels back in 2020, would you say, or where are we now with regards to sufficient vitamin D intake and COVID severity and all that stuff?
Yeah, during COVID, we didn't really know anything. Everyone was trying every sort of treatment, every drug, every nutrition supplement they could think of, because we just didn't know anything at all. We were just hoping something would work. From what we know now, there's two recent trials came out last week. It looks like vitamin D didn't have as big an effect as it thought it would have had. So it's not to say vitamin D will be useless for COVID. Vitamin D is good for the immune system. It's good for priming the immune system for infection and doing its job properly. It's not COVID specific. It's good for overall general immune health.
Yeah.
It's not the magic bullet. That's what we've all been saying. It's not going to be. There's no one thing that's going to be the magic solution.
Yeah. Yeah, it's about having an optimal immune system, I guess, and you know, whatever disease or illness comes along, it's going to give us a better chance to fight it, I guess. That'd be correct.
Exactly. I mean, the majority of people, unfortunately, are deficient in vitamin D, and if you give them vitamin D to become sufficient, that's obviously going to help everything, including the immune system.
Yeah. And which brings me to my next question, what is the optimal level? And is the optimal level the same for everybody? So if I'm 6'2" and 95 kilos, is the dosage of vitamin D that I need, is that the same as someone who's 5' and 50 kilos? Is that?
Well, it all depends on obesity levels as well, because people who are obese or have excess, say, fat, a lot of them do actually get sucked into fat storage. So if
Okay.
you have too much, it just gets deposited in the fat cells, and obviously you can't use it then.
Okay.
So it does depend on your level of body fat as well. So people with a
Okay.
higher level of body fat require more vitamin D because more of it's just getting sucked up into the cells.
Wow, yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, I've never come across that. I know you hear bits and pieces about vitamin D, but stuff like that, there's a real really interesting. Another thing I was thinking about is you have so many studies are so vast. There's even one I saw one was linked with like ultraviolet light, vitamin D levels, COVID. It was trying to connect the dots there. But how do you come up with the studies that you're involved in? Do you have like a hypothesis in your head? Is it something that you've maybe read somebody else's work and then you try and fill it out or try and plug the gaps, as it were?
Oh yeah, exactly. I mean, there's so many gaps in what we don't know in vitamin D and other nutrients as well.
Yeah.
For example, in Ireland, we very little on ethnic minorities. We know hardly anything at all,
Yeah.
or in any special groups, vulnerable adults, those in nursing homes, prisoners. You name it, the list goes on. And what we do as researchers is try and fill that gap. So
Yeah.
then we can back in policy and say, look, we need to look at this group and maybe say, look, you have to take X amount of vitamin D, or this group is more at risk, so we have to focus our public health policy on that.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's very interesting because there's such a diverse range. I know it's all around vitamin D, but there's some stuff that you're like, how would you ever think of that? And it just fascinates me how you come up with the concept of it, to test it and go, actually, there's nothing, not really that much to that theory we had, or it's not as consequential as we thought it was.
Yeah, sometimes it's even more fun stuff as well. We're looking at vitamin D in the woolly mammoth at the moment, so it's more sort of out there.
Yeah, very good. And with regards to vitamin D levels, we like the people know the sun is one of the places we can get. Is it we get vitamin D from the sun, or is it helps our body produce vitamin D? Which way around is it?
So the UVB sunlight sort of hits the skin, and we have pre-vitamin D in the skin. And it sort of forms a chemical reaction with that. Then it gets transported to the liver, and then another reaction happens. And finally, it gets transported to the kidney, and that's where we get the active vitamin D.
Yeah,
But
so yeah,
yeah,
so
it is true, we can get it from the sun, but only between, say, in Ireland, say, between March and September. After that, I mean, you could go out there naked during the winter, and you'll not make one bit of vitamin D. You get frozen, and you
do you recommend that?
Well, probably not, unless you want to go for a sea dip. It might help something else, but not your vitamin D.
Get arrested, Eamon. Can't we give my that sort of advice here? Yeah, that's what's gonna ask my next question is, so those sort of 6 months odd of the year, March to September, was it? Those are the times that we have our best chance to get our vitamin D topped up via the sun. And outside of that, is it supplements? Is it diet? What is the best way, or what can people do to keep optimal vitamin D levels throughout the year?
Unfortunately for us here in Ireland and most Western countries, we don't consume enough foods that contain vitamin D. The best sort of foods is oily fish, egg yolks, sort of offal organ foods, heart, liver. We just don't eat enough of them. We probably can't eat enough of those. Nobody's going to eat a fish every single day forever. You can't. Nobody can afford that. The best way of probably getting it is through supplementation. That's one of the few vitamins that we actually recommend you probably should supplement, because you just can't get it naturally from the diet. Not enough.
And with regards to supplementation, I think most people are familiar with vitamin D3, at least that's the one I would kind of know of the most. Is that the best one, or how many variations are there?
Well,
How do you know kind of what to go for?
it goes from, say, vitamin D1 up to, say, I don't know, I think it's vitamin D9 or vitamin D10. There's a whole lot of very different variations. D3 is mostly what we get from animals. D2 is from mushrooms and plants. But we have studies showing that D3 is more effective than D2. So if you're going for anything, I would recommend going for D3. But again, if you're vegetarian or vegan, D2 is also it's less effective, but another way of getting it.
Yeah, it's all good, but D3's looks at the minute as the most effective one way.
Oh yeah, we know
Yeah,
it's
for sure.
scientific for sure that we
Yeah,
know D3 is
yeah.
the best.
And with regards to different demographics, so like one end of the scale, older people, younger end of the scale, babies even, I think vitamin D supplementation for expectant mothers, that's a big thing now, isn't it? What have you looked into any of that sort of area? Or
yeah, we've looked at different population groups. Well, surprisingly, people who are most deficient in the population are actually people like us, aged between in their 20s to late 30s. That's the people who are most deficient.
Wow.
In fact, even more deficient than, say, an 80-year-old or 90-year-old, which is incredible.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, we're not out getting the sun. We're working. A lot of people have probably turned vegan or vegetarian. They don't like taking supplements. They're not taking dairy foods. They're not taking fortified foods. And then, of course, our levels are going down.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, I wouldn't have thought. That's really shocking.
It's bad. I mean, we're setting ourselves up for, 20 to 30 years osteoporosis, which is not good. Definitely is not something that you want.
Yeah. Are there any misunderstandings or concepts that people have in their head about vitamin D that you come up against that, like, they're just completely false, or they're completely, people have dreamt them up and they've kind of taken legs, and for one reason or another, everybody thinks something wrong about it? Is there anything new?
Yeah, people think, well, if you just go out in the sun, then that's it. You don't need to worry about getting a supplement or taking any food. And some people get very confused about sort of the sun cream aspect of protecting yourself and also getting vitamin D at the same time.
Yeah.
So I think the general rule is to go out in the sun for the first 5 to 10 minutes, get your vitamin D, and then put your sun cream on, your sun hat, and sun protection.
Yeah.
And that way you get the best of both. You get your vitamin D and lower risk of skin cancer.
Yeah.
Because if you do the sun cream first, then that's it. It blocks the vitamin D, you won't get nothing.
Oh, really? The sun cream? So if you put it on that early, there's not much benefit with regards to vitamin D.
It blocks the UVB light. So if you don't get the UVB light, you don't make any vitamin D, unfortunately.
So like the end of the day and the start of the day, like sunset, sunrise, are those important times that they to get more sunlight, because I guess it's not as strong then, so you're less likely to get skin cancer and burnt, etc., from that, but you're going to get some sort of UV. Would that be a good tactic for people?
The best UVB for vitamin D is probably between 12 o'clock and 4 o'clock, but that's also when the sun is at the strongest.
Okay.
There is a balance to be had, but we know from studies like 5 to 10 minutes is probably enough, and you're actually reducing your risk of sunburn. You won't get sunburned in 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Put your sun cream on then, because unfortunately after 4 o'clock, well, that's it. You're still going to get skin damage, but you won't make vitamin D. It's just due to the angle of the sun.
Yeah. And is it enough to kind of be like shorts and t-shirt, no hat on? Is that going to be enough exposure to the UV light? Is that going to be enough?
You know, have your arms, have your legs for the first 10 minutes, and then your body's very, very effective.
Yeah.
It can't overproduce vitamin D. There's sort of like a negative feedback that won't allow you to produce too much vitamin D.
Yeah. So anybody who's doing naked sunbathing, it's overkill.
Yeah, definitely. That's too much. Unless you want a complete overtan of everything.
What would you say? So we already touched on it, but what are some of the symptoms that maybe people need to be aware of when it comes to vitamin D deficiency? Without having a test or anything done, what are some of the things that we need to look out for?
Yeah, there's no real scientific proper symptoms of vitamin D. What we do is we test the blood to find out if something's deficient or not. But a study my PhD student is doing at the moment, she was actually looking at symptoms of people have been reporting of if they've had vitamin D deficiency. So a lot of people are actually reporting tiredness, lack of energy, aches and pains. It's quite a common sort of indication. Lethargy, and I think also maybe lack of sleep. Maybe some people think important.
Yeah.
But there's a variation of symptoms that, you know, some people just don't feel right. They go to the doctor checks the vitamin D and it's actually quite low.
Yeah. And I guess if someone's carrying more body fat, like we said at the start, they're more likely to look out for those things, I guess.
Exactly, and as everyone as well, I mean, particularly athletes, for some reason, athletes are actually at a higher risk of
low vitamin D.
And we know from study on Colerain showing that the GAA and rugby athletes actually had high levels of low vitamin D.
Yeah, well, I suppose even like we think of multivitamins, there's certain multivitamins you can get for if you're highly active, compared to someone who's not as active, so like sports versions. and all the levels are a little bit higher, I guess, because they're burning through lots of minerals, they're sweating more, they're doing all sorts of other things.
Yeah, they probably have higher requirements for the muscle mass as well. The higher your muscle, then vitamin D is essential for your type 2 muscles.
Yeah, that's interesting as well. So kind of two people at either end of the spectrum, those who are sedentary and those who are highly active, and interesting. So yes, once you've ruled out all that, if you're sleeping, you're not sleeping well, and you've kind of ticked all the other boxes to figure out why you're not sleeping well, fatigue, inflammation, is that one of the things that, if you're kind of chronically?
Vitamin D is associated with inflammation, that if you have low levels, you're more likely to have sort of more the pro-inflammatory type of inflammation.
Okay.
Particularly for older adults, if they actually have enough vitamin D, then they're going to store towards like an anti-inflammatory profile in their blood.
Yeah.
Which is pretty good for aging and longevity, because as you age, then you unfortunately just your immune system doesn't work as well as it should.
Yeah.
And you have risk of inflammation, potentially then at least cardiovascular disease, cancer, other conditions associated with getting old.
Yeah. Yeah. And I was wondering as well, see, with regards to so we're saying about sports and things like that, are there any specific sports that people need to watch if they're doing certain, you mentioned the GAA, is there anything, any other sports that they're particularly prone to the vitamin D that you know of?
Well, from a few studies that I've been looking at, it's GAA, it's rugby, anything that's sort of high impact, high muscle sports.
Yeah.
And also particularly as well, gymnastics and jockeys as well are at a high risk of low vitamin D.
Yeah.
They're actually limiting their weight and their intakes for their sport.
Yeah.
And then by doing that, they're at high risk of deficiency in everything.
Wow, yeah. And are there any other vitamins or minerals that we should be taking in conjunction with vitamin D to make it more effective or to have maximum absorption or whatever the term is?
Yeah, for vitamin D, for maximum absorption, it's better taken with a type of fat. So any type of fat will probably do.
Okay.
So if you're eating, say, you could be having salmon and maybe take some mashed potatoes with a bit of butter or a bit of cheese, something that contains a little bit of fat, it just increases the absorption because it is fat soluble.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. And with regards to, how did you get into looking at vitamin D particularly? I mean, I've often wondered that, like, of all the vitamins there are, what drew you to vitamin D?
Well, I suppose at the very start, I seen an article in New Scientist. Well, it must be 12, 15 years ago. I was just reading it and it just seemed very sort of very interesting. Nobody has done much in it at that time. It was a new upcoming vitamin that people were interested in.
Yeah. Very good. Yeah.
And I think it's still out there as a sort of number one vitamin that people are keenly aware of.
Yeah. I think, in the last 2 years, because there was so much, headlines regarding vitamin D and COVID, et cetera, and every man and his dog on the street kind of knew that, knew there was something to do with vitamin D, or they suspected there was something, and I guess we didn't know fully a year or two ago what the implications were. But it's good we know an awful lot more now, I guess, about
it's great. I mean, a lot of people are more aware than ever were, and hopefully their blood levels are much improved.
Yeah. But as you said, it kind of goes for every illness, every disease, doesn't it? If anything, respiratory illness, if it involves our immune system, if it involves our immune system taking a whack, or we're not at an optimal level, it doesn't matter what the disease or illness comes our way, we're going to take a beating if we're not prepared for it, I guess.
Exactly. It's just one sort of component or one jigsaw. I mean, if there's other vitamins, there's, say, zinc, selenium, your micronutrients as well, your proteins, your fats.
Yeah,
you need a good combination of everything to have an optimal immune system.
Yeah. How does sleep affect vitamin D levels? Is there any link there? Have you looked into that kind of things?
I haven't looked at it myself, but I think a few people have. But the lack of vitamin D could affect the neurotransmitters involved in sleep.
Okay.
If you're lacking that, you're lacking sort of an essential component needed to make other things needed for sleep.
Yeah. Yeah. Because there's so many negative things come from getting a lack of sleep or poor quality sleep.
Yeah.
I would be surprised if there wasn't some sort of a knock-on effect with regards to our minerals and how our body absorbs, processes things.
Exactly. It could be a negative feedback if you're not getting enough sleep, or you're not getting enough vitamin D, then you're not eating properly, you're not thinking properly, then your intakes are low, and it's sort of a cycle going around.
I know if I have a bad night's sleep, so the little one keeps me up, and I know within like the next day or two I'm gonna get a cold or something. I just know I'm gonna get it because I know my immune system's kind of taking a whack, and I never noticed it before until the last couple of years, and I was getting a cold every once a month. But it's all sorts of negative impacts, even with regards to our diet. Like the next day, we kind of know you're probably gonna eat another 300 or 400 calories on average if you had a bad night's sleep than you otherwise would do. So.
Yeah, it's sort of like a feedback thing with your body. It's sort of like you're sort of treating yourself. You make you feel a little bit depressed. You make you a little bit more. You feel a little bit better.
Yeah.
It's a coping mechanism of your body.
Yeah. So what does Dr. Eamon Laird do if he's trying to keep fit? I see on Instagram, you're like every weekend you're doing surfing, you're doing hiking, you're doing camping, you're all over the place.
It's a little bit of everything, a little bit of adventure sports, nothing too dangerous, nothing you're going to die with, but you know, something to keep you on edge. I like going surfing, hiking, climbing, good bit of running now, back into that. A bit of cold water dips as well. I do a lot of that in Dublin.
Yeah.
Every weekend, maybe just going for a dip for 5 minutes, you know, no wetsuit, just in.
Yeah.
Used to the cold, and then you're already in then.
Yeah. Have you started doing that recently, in recent years, or have you always?
No, just when COVID started, then I started doing that and got used to it. And then, I have to say, it's very, very good for during winter, but I mean, it gives you a bit good shock when you go in.
Yeah.
First 1 minute, that's the toughest.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you ever get out and feel like your skin's kind of burning? Like, that's what happens to me. I feel like my skin's like on fire, and then it's really hard to get warmed up. Probably staying in too long, I guess, but I haven't done it for a while. I used to do it when I lived beside the sea.
Yeah. No, exactly. Well, sometimes you're in, you get past that stage and you don't feel anything anymore, man. Probably too long.
Where's the best place you've been surfing? Is it in Ireland mostly you go surfing, or would you go further afield?
Yeah, mostly in Ireland. It's Donegal, Macross Head. It's sort of a secret spot. It's very, very good.
Yeah.
The water is so clean.
Yeah.
It's just like somewhere in the tropics.
Yeah.
No sewage, no nothing. It's all natural. And up in Port Stewart is quite good too.
Yeah. Yeah, some good spots there. And what about hiking? Where's the best spot? You haven't been to the Mourns yet, have you, hiking? Have you been?
No. Yeah, it's on the list to do.
You haven't been to the Mourns?
I know.
Yeah, man, you're missing out. That's the best place.
It is. I've heard good stories from up there. Go hopefully maybe in October before the winter sets in.
Yeah, it's so close to you. I mean, it's only like an hour away. But an hour from Dublin. It's not too far. Loads of nice places to stay. If you need a good resource, have you ever seen Trek NI? Yeah, it's a great resource. Loads of good stuff there if you need any good hikes and things. And you go camping quite often, do you?
Wild camping, that's most weekends. I mean, it's the only way to do it. If you're out in the countryside and you're away from adventure weekend, you have to go camping. You just can't go glamping. That's definitely a no-no.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I used to go camping more. In my head, I like it as an idea, and then it's going to be great fun, it's going to be exciting. And then the next day, I just wake up, I've got an achy back, and my back's in pieces, and you haven't slept well, and you've probably got, like, midget bites or something on you. But I suppose you go in, like, the winter or autumn time, it's not as bad.
It's not too bad. The thing is, be prepared. Bring everything you need, your camping stuff, your stove, your sleeping bag. You have to have a list.
Yeah.
If you get anything essential, then you're standard for the weekend.
Yeah. And have you climbed all down around Curry, Carranta Hill and all those? Yeah.
They were amazing during the summer.
Yeah.
We actually went to Snowdonia as well last year, or this year.
Wow.
That was fantastic.
Awesome.
Surfing place in the mountains itself.
Yeah.
I've never seen anything like it. Right up in the middle of the mountains, an indoor, outdoor artificial surf.
Yeah, wow, that's incredible. We went to the stake a few years back, must be 6 or 7 years ago. We went down on the day before New Year's Eve, and we tried to hike it on New Year's Eve, and we couldn't even see Carranta Hill. Like, we're looking up, and we're just like, where is it? The clouds had just come down, we couldn't see anywhere. So stayed over in a B&B and then tried to tack it the next day, and it was a bit better. We couldn't really see too much, but we went ahead with it. And the rivers were so swollen. We couldn't even get across. We had to follow these other guys who were from Wicklow, and they showed us up around the other way. I get them mixed up. There's like Heaven's Gate and the Devil's Ladder, Heaven's Gate, or something like that.
Yeah,
all the way around, maybe.
The cliff drops are very steep.
Yeah,
they're
yeah, they are.
Very steep.
Yeah, I kept looking down and thinking, if I slip here, this is all over. This is game over. But not as a class climb. It's really, really nice. What about the UK? Have you climbed like Ben Nevis or tried any of those?
No, not yet. I mean, I would like to go to Scotland. It's on the list as well. I mean, maybe the winter time might be a little bit dangerous. Hopefully, maybe next spring.
Yeah.
There's not too much snow. That would be amazing to do.
Yeah. Oh, I thought of another question for you. Back on the vitamin D topic, actually. With regards to vitamin D being fat soluble, if you are I guess it's a big danger for some people, some of my clients, they might think if they're trying to cut calories or trying to get in shape or lose weight, they might think of going for low fat, low fat, low fat. They'll try and cut fat out of their diet, which is a mistake in my opinion, but it's probably even more of a mistake in your opinion with regards to the vitamin D. Would that be correct?
Yeah, in terms of vitamin D and in terms of overall health. For example, we know now that dairy fat is very, very different from animal meat fat. It's a different type of saturated fat. It's been associated actually with lower BMI, lower risk of cardiovascular disease. And you have to remember that like the majority of our cells, you know, we need fat for the, it's like called a phospholipid layer around the cells. And we don't have enough fat, you know, we can't function. It is an essential component of the diet.
Yeah.
And there's just been such a controversy about fat recently that, you know, yes, you should probably not eat an awful lot, but you still have to have a certain amount in your diet.
Yeah.
And it's just not healthy if you don't.
Yeah.
If you're all your fat out, it's not good.
Yeah. Even, it's kind of funny, like, I guess it's probably further, it's probably like 80, in the 80s and 90s and stuff, there was this whole craze of like, don't eat fat, and like, low fat, and they come up with all these products, low fat, low fat. But what they did, it was a lot of times they filled them up with sugar and things. So a lot of those low fat or no fat products, you check them and like the sugary carbohydrates are huge because they've probably put sugar in there, which is a cheap ingredient, but it sells. If it says low fat or no fat on it, people are going to buy it because they think low fat automatically means low calories, automatically means healthy. And it's just not the case. Even if we, there's this idea that if we eat fat, we become fat. Like, you are what you eat, and I know we are in one sense, but it doesn't work just as simply as that.
It's a big mistake, isn't it?
Yeah, and we need it, like as you said, we need it for all of our basic bodily functions, our metabolism, our immune system, brain function, all sorts of things, don't we?
Everything. I mean, you should be eating at least 2 or 3 fish a week. That's just to get the omega-3 essential fat. Never mind all other types of fat you need.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's fascinating, but it seems like I guess like most the general public and I guess the media as well is maybe responsible for it, but it takes a while before they catch up with the latest, you know, what we kind of learn, and then it moves on. Unless you're kind of staying abreast of it and you're only watching the media and maybe this morning or something on TV, you know, it's maybe not as up to date as what it should be, and you kind of have to watch out, don't you?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's very confusing for people. I know there's some headlines during the week in the Daily Mail that, I mean, one day it could be saying, this is bad for you, and the very next day it's saying, well, exactly the opposite. This is what you need to do. So it gets so confusing for people who don't know any different. And we're, you know, it's our job as scientists and researchers to try and make it as simple as possible and try to, you know, say this is the way it should be. But it's probably our fault ourselves, the scientists. A lot of them are actually putting out too many press releases, too many things about their own, about research. It's contradicting other research, and it's just confusing people.
Yeah. Yeah, that's one of the things that annoys me sometimes with, like the Daily Mail, you're saying there's other ones as well, but like someone actually put together a collage of like Daily Mail headlines, you know, it was like, this thing gives you cancer, this thing, you know, like it would give you all these things that basically killed you and in a short space of time. And by the end of it, you're like, what can I eat? Is there anything I can consume that's like not going to kill me immediately? So yeah, there's loads of them do it. And if you add them all up, it would be, you probably would just be living in fresh air. And even then you might be afraid of the, you know, pollution in the air. But
yeah, I mean, there's a whole thing about bacon last year. They worked out that if you eat a certain amount of bacon, it's going to take X amount of like time off your life.
Yeah.
But yeah. I mean, nobody's going to be probably eating bacon every single day. And now a bacon sandwich is probably okay. You're going to enjoy it. It's worth that little bit of like 0.01 seconds.
Yeah.
That doesn't really count for anything.
Yeah.
There's a bit of enjoyment now rather than being, well, miserable, thinking you should have done something, but
yeah,
0.0 of a second.
Yeah, I know some of those stats, I guess, they come up, and I know why they do it, because it's supposed to kind of simplify it in our head, you know, the public's head, but sometimes it can really, like, put the fear of God in people. They can be like, what, like, you know, this is going to take this many years off me, and some people might not care, but other people that might terrify them into, like, you know, not doing something, like, they really enjoy the odd time every weekend or every so often. But one of my pet peeves, Eamon, is whenever someone, or whenever you see a study, or whenever you see like a newspaper article, and they'll put together in the same bracket processed meat and red meat, as if that's the exact same thing. And so as if a sausage, like a sausage which is full of all sorts of dirt, and it tastes nice, right? But it's full of dirt, and like a nice steak, right? I'm trying to say that they're the same thing, and they're going to have the same impact on the human body, or the same impact on our longevity and our health. It kind of annoys me, because if you look at, it's always the way. I don't know if it's the media. It probably is the media doing that, and they're trying to banish those two together. But yeah, it's one of, that's my high horse that I like to get up on and point out.
Yeah, no, you're exactly right. They're two different completely things. I mean, processed meat is meat that's been processed and added, say, for example, nitrates or stabilizers. And then you have your organic meat, your grass-fed meat,
yeah,
which, you know, it's very, very two different animals. Well, not animals, but two different very things. You can't really compare them both.
Yeah. Yeah, and I guess like as you said, like about processed foods and whole foods, as a general health principle, it's probably a good idea to go for as many whole foods and as few processed foods as we can, if we're thinking about longevity and optimal health.
Yeah, definitely try and go for the sort of raw, organic, unprocessed as much as possible. But again, in saying that, some processed foods are actually quite good for you. For example, fortified cereals are fantastic. You know, they've added vitamins and minerals that you just won't get naturally that you actually need. So if you say, look at, say, a normal porridge versus a, say, supermarket porridge, I would always go for the supermarket porridge,
yeah,
because it has the extra protein, extra minerals, extra vitamins added in.
Yeah.
So sometimes processed can be good at times.
Yeah. It's an interesting place we're in the world right now, because decades ago, maybe even a generation or two ago, the crops that they used back then, I mean, it's not the same type of crop that we are getting now in our food. You know, they've been tweaked so much, and they're not actually absorbing the same amount of nutrients from the ground to produce the crop now. So we're kind of at a disadvantage from our parents or grandparents from what they were getting, even though it's in a mass production now. But the soil has been so beat up, I guess, because it's been used so much. But also, even all the pesticides and things like that have gone into the ground. I'm reading the book actually at the minute called, it's actually up there, Mineral Fix. It's quite interesting, but it made the point about how the crops are absorbing the heavy metals. So there's like a competition going on for like the essential nutrients our bodies need, essential minerals, and then the heavy metals. And the crops are kind of, there's a competition going on there for what's going to get absorbed. So there's going to be less of the essential stuff that we need, and more kind of heavy metals potentially in our crops. They're not the catastrophic levels, but to the point where we're not going to get as much value from those crops as we would have done a century before, for example. Have you heard that before, or come across that before?
Well, I suppose in the field, is, you know, there's just probably too much industrial commercial farming.
Yeah.
The land can only give a certain amount if we have to keep adding fertilizers and adding everything in.
Yeah.
The whole big problem is we have too many of this sort of single crops that we rely on. Like probably like three or four crops that we get most of our food supply from.
Yeah.
Whereas there are actually just hundreds of different varieties of things we can actually use.
Yeah.
But the whole food global system is centered on just three to four essential crops. And that's just doing the damage, it's ruining sort of everything.
Yeah.
If something happens to those crops, we're stuck. We don't have anything.
Yeah. Yeah. So grow your own. Is that the advice?
Well, if you've got the land and the time to do it.
It's hard to grow a garden full of wheat, I guess.
Yeah, you can't do it. You can't grow potatoes in my balcony, but that's only enough for like 2 days.
Yeah. Yeah. No, well, Eamon, it's been great chatting. We're coming up in the close to the time now, but we wanted to get you up to have a workout and then do it in person. But hopefully we can maybe do it again sometime. We can have the crack and we'll get a few more topics to talk about, and we'll get a good work, get a good workout in, will that do?
Yeah, that's fantastic. Yeah, I've seen you on Instagram. Looks like you're really pushing the clients and got your gym. It looks amazing.
Yeah, I've got some great clients, great clientele. Hopefully some of them are listening to this. It better be. I'll be testing them. But it's a lot of benefit. Thank you for sharing your wisdom with us. And before we go, do you have a joke for us? We try to ask guests for a joke, a really terrible joke, if possible.
Oh, yeah. I've been trying to think of an MD one. Unfortunately, there is no MD jokes. I do have a bone health one, though. So I have an osteoporosis joke, but I'm not sure if it's humorous.
Go for it.
That's it?
Yeah.
No, that is a joke.
What is it? I didn't hear it.
Well, I have an osteoporosis joke, but I'm not sure if it's humorous.
That's bad enough to be on this podcast, because that's equally as bad as mine. It was so bad I missed it the first time around. Thank you very much, Eamon. And hopefully we'll catch up in person soon. Thank you for sharing your time.
Yep, grand. Thanks, Jared.
Perfect. Take care, Eamon.
See you.
Bye.
We'll be right back.